All right. Hey, it's Fran again. This is Project Egress Mission Log Day 9, and I've had a bit of a recharge. Made some progress over at the factory, milling the basic components. And since my last video, I was really hitting the wall. But what I ended up doing was to make things more efficient at the milling station that I had set up over at the factory for the Shaper Origin. After doing the base, which took a long time, took like 3 days just to rough out the base, I decided what I would do, and I've refined this process in the week or so since I've been doing it. But what I've come down to doing is when I cut out a new block, I take into consideration the layering and the steps and the work I have to do just to get down to the first layers, the first faces that are going to be on the top of the piece as I mill it down. And so when I'm doing the actual drawings, the DWG files for the milling operations, I also make a template, just a blank stamp that I use just to create a pocket for that shape in the block that will allow me to quickly mill down the wood to the layer of the first face that's going to be in that part. So when I arrange all the different components of an assembly into the block in the virtual space, first thing I do is I arrange a bunch of these pocket blocks, and I've already done the math on the drawings to figure out how much I have to eliminate in each pocket to get down to the face level, thinking, you know, this the level, the thickness of the block, all the blocks are 19.1 millimeters, so I have to subtract the material working in negative numbers, because the origin is coming from a negative number as far as the part that I'm milling is concerned. So I have to subtract the numbers out from the top face down to the bottom, because the bottom of the block is zero. So I'm going negative. So I start by arranging these pockets and then milling down in layers. I'm taking, you know, down the pockets, take down to the first face of each component. And then I start to do the various milling operations to shape out the first layers and the second layers. And after I drill the holes, mill them out, and the holes I've milled out to tolerance, some of the internal parts, the parts that move, are going to be have these brass inserts around the pins, which is something that Scott suggested. It actually helps to reinforce the wood so that you don't have the short grain problem, as it's called, which is the problems of when the grain of the wood gets really short, that you're dealing with the ability of the wood to hold its fibers together rather than depending on the length of the grain for the strength, and it's a different kind of a force, even in walnut. So that had to be taken into consideration with these brass inserts, which actually will take the stresses of the pins. And so I've milled out the holes where pins are go through for these brass inserts. When all the milling operations are done and they're all formed, all the pieces in the block are formed, there's still a 1 millimeter layer holding all the pieces in the block. And the final step is to switch to a smaller bit and very carefully mill out and to part these individual pieces out of the block. And I found early on with the base that this is a very precarious step with these small parts, because the wood is stuck down to the sacrificial layer with double-sided tape, which works fine for really large objects. But using a pull-up bit and a router, you have the problem of when the parts are really small, the forces of the bit working on the wood will be greater than the force of the tape holding it down, and it'll get torn up off of the bed before the milling operation is complete. And when that happens, the part flops around in the cavity and gets chomped up by the bit, and it just gets destroyed. I had a couple of examples of that happen early on. And so I learned to do this sort of stencil cutout process where I, when I'm getting down to that last millimeter, I take into consideration the direction of the grain, and I do like a stencil cutout on two sides, and then only and very carefully and very slowly cut out those last two little bits, those little tabs, to keep the piece from getting dislodged and knocking around in the cavity. This stencil release sort of parting process has worked out pretty well. In the last few days, I've had a lot of small parts that I've been able to mill out and release without having any damage to them. So it's been a lot of progress. And there were just a few interruptions along the way. Bird alerts would go off. Dot, the shop bird, when she hears me knocking around in my shop, she often likes to come in and visit me. And there were a few Dot visits to be had to interrupt the tedious boredom, well, not boredom, but to interrupt the tedium of my many, many dozens of milling operations. It's really gotten into the hundreds at this point. When you take into consideration that every time, for every layer, you have to pocket, and then for every layer, you're milling out outside of the perimeter of a layer first, like a millimeter out, 2 millimeters out, and then you're switching out a bit to a finer bit, and then going in and finally detailing a final pass right up to the part. So many bit changes. I was, you know, changing. There were other restrictions, like the finer bits aren't as long. So when you're doing deeper parts, you can't just use a finer bit right off. And if you're working way down to the bottom, you can't use a fine bit if it's, you know, deeper than, you know, 10 millimeters or something, because the finer bits have a shorter length on the cutting part of the bit. So yeah, there was so many considerations and planning and changing out of bits. And every time you change a bit, you've got to reset the machine. You have to do a Z-touch to realign the Z-axis with the bit. You have to change out the bit numbers in the machine so that it knows what it's using. Lots of time just in setup for every single layer of the process, for every layer of every component of every part. And then these various components, like the rotor assembly, was broken down into 4 different major components in dozens and dozens of layers. And all these components are going to be, you know, assembled into a single solid piece. And there's going to be a lot of manual operations I'm going to have to do to complete these pieces. After I get the rotor all assembled and glued and bonded together, there's going to be manual processes I'm going to have to do, either by hand or with the manual milling machine that we have in the shop, to get some of these final angles and passes done. And there's going to be a lot of hand finishing and surface work. And also, holes have to be drilled in some of the odd axes, and those have to be done in my drill press with some, and I have to come up with some blocks to square these pieces so that they can be held at various specific angles so that drilling operations can be done. And then there's going to be some radiuses I'm going to have to form on these parts in the upcoming week and everything. So a lot of finishing work on all of the various parts in the assembly. So a lot of work still yet to be done. Today I'm going to be milling the latch arm puller. It's going to be done in 2 parts. And it's going to be bonded, so one seam down the middle. But, you know, this will allow me to do most of the milling operations with the origin and combine it in 2 pieces, again, with a brass insert. It's going to make it in one solid piece, using the brass inserts not only as a bearing for the pins, but also structurally to bond all the layers together to make, like, a singular strong anchor point for everything else, for all these different parts that are made out of more than one piece. So the final note on the project really is that I'm my decision to use the shaper origin for this has been a painful one, because the origin was never designed or intended to do any of the kinds of work that I'm making it do, trying to make it do. It was never intended to do real CNC work. And the software, the firmware that it runs in, there's no way that you can't set an arbitrary zero point on the virtual work surface to, and set that zero point in all your artwork so you can line everything to like a base point. It's not designed to do that. So I mean, that's one of the fundamental principles of machining, is having zero, having a point in the X, Y, and Z axis that is zero, by which you base all of your other operations on. And that doesn't exist in the origin. And so I've had to create these sort of, getting around the peculiarities of the origin and the lacking of having that option, I've had to use some of the built-in structures of the firmware, where you can align things to the virtual grid in the virtual workspace, either like center bottom or bottom left or bottom right. And so I've basically had to create these artificial spots, like in the zero left or on the bottom left as zero for some of these assemblies and other ones, but also what they don't take into consideration, you can't do that if you're off the grid. And because I'm working with wood, I'm having to rotate the various parts to drop in the part that I'm going to mill out of the wood based on the grain structure. So if the grain is going this way and I've got a part that goes this way and I want to line it up so that the grain structure is going to sort of stay straight through a curved part, I'm going to drop it in there at an odd angle, and there's no way to put several layers of artwork in that same position in the origin. It's not designed to do that. So I've had to develop all of these sideline techniques and ways of getting around and working with the peculiarities of the origin to get results, and it's been a very painful process, to be sure. So. All right, so that's it, day 9, and I've got to get back to the factory, and I've got more milling to do. But after today, I should have all of the origin milled components of the various parts. And so the next few days will be having me assembling these various raw components into the raw parts, like the rotor and the puller and such, into the raw parts, and then I'll be able to start doing the finishing, surfacing, and the manual operations, which is the additional holes I have to drill for the various pins, and also the milling operations I have to do to put bevels and chamfers and some other finishing and interior mills that I got to do on some of these parts. Those have to be completed in the next few days. And then also hand sanding and surface finishing to smooth out and get the surfaces all correct. And also I'll have to cut down the brass tubing and the pins and all that stuff for the fittings. All that will have to be done over the next week. And so hopefully, I mean, I'm shooting for having like Friday, maybe having something close to completion. If I don't screw something up and wreck an assembly and have to start over or remake something, that's what I really don't want to do. So, yeah. Anyway, that's it for day 9, Project Egress, formerly hashtag Super Secret Project, now it's hashtag Project Egress, or hashtag Apollo 50. So, thanks to all my patrons for hanging in there, being very patient, waiting for this like week and a half, 2 weeks that I'm not publishing anything about this project. Although I did get the notice today from the project overlords that on Friday the 28th, they're supposed to make a public announcement, and after that point I can start publishing these video logs and start talking about the project, so I'm told, at least in an official project handouts that I've gotten. So so it looks like maybe within a week or so I'll be publishing the first of these videos and talking about the project and yada yada. So anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll see you back here in a day or two with the next update.